Hello, welcome to my channel Medicine with Dr. Moran. If you've not been here before, my name is Dr. Keith Moran. My channel has a number of general medical videos, including procedures that I do, as well as a number of videos on COVID, including evidence-based data on the vaccines in terms of benefits, as well as side effects, and other topics, including natural immunity. There's a link to my natural immunity playlist up here on the screen. Today, I want to talk about one of the most serious problems that have come out of the COVID-19 pandemic. This is the problem of obesity. I'm going to talk about obesity in adults during COVID, then the complications of obesity, and finally, I want to talk about kids and obesity during COVID as well. A lot of my patients joke that they have their COVID-20, referring to the 20 pounds they've put on through the pandemic. Throughout the pandemic, I've spoken to a number of my personal patients, trying to keep them active and to try to prevent things like snacking, poor food choices, and simply eating more in general. It's what you would expect when the population is told to shelter in place or to lock down. I have been pleased with a small number of people who actually have taken the time to make lifestyle changes to improve their health in general. Unfortunately, most people have seen a reduction in their health because of either weight gain or lack of exercise. It's always sad to hear that. Patients that really enjoy going to the gym or doing exercise with other people did not replace this with other activities during the pandemic. As I've mentioned to countless people over nearly the last couple of years, the chance of picking up this virus when you're outdoors exercising physically separated from other people is virtually nil. The pandemic has really put a focus on obesity, not just because people have gained weight, but the fact that this is one of the leading comorbidities that predicts severe illness and death from COVID. As I reported in this video, the biggest comorbidity was that of obesity. The study was an observational study of about 500,000 people, and the risk of death was 30% higher if someone was obese. The risk of hospitalization and ICU admission were also increased in people with obesity. This slide from the study shows the comorbidities found in hospitalized patients from the age of 18 to 39. And as you can see, there were 59,697 people in that age group in the study. The biggest risk factor was obesity, with 37% of people that age having obesity. If you were obese, your risk of death was increased by 120%. Or said another way, you were 2.2 times more likely to die compared to somebody who was not obese. The risk of invasive mechanical ventilation, which means going on a breathing machine to prolong life, was 76% increased, or 1.76 times, and ICU admission was increased by 30%, or 1.3 times. We know that in adults, there have been significant changes in weight with this pandemic. This study I want to talk about is peer-reviewed and published in the Journal of the American Medical Association. It demonstrated an increase in body weight in an observational study done throughout the United States. There's a link to the study below if you want to read further. In my videos, I've always tried to put a link to each study that I talk about in the description. If for some reason in any of my videos, if it's missing, please make a comment in the comment section and I will remedy that. Overall, they saw an increase of 1.5 pounds of weight gain every month in this study. Now, 1.5 pounds is 0.7 kilograms per month. This is in adults, but what about children? I want to look briefly at two studies recently reported looking at weight gain in the pediatric population during the pandemic. This first one is from the CDC, and they looked at a large group of kids between 2 and 19. There were 432,302 in this study, and they used the BMI, which is the body mass index. Now, the BMI is a ratio of weight to height. This is how it's calculated. There are many BMI calculators online, and you simply need to put in your weight and your height to compute the number. BMI isn't perfect, but there isn't another way that's easy, quick, and cheap to do. There is a video on my channel going into more depth about body mass index. These are the adult categories for BMI, all the way from the underweight group all the way up to the different grades of obesity. And a normal BMI is 18.5 to 24.9. The categories or ranges for BMI are actually lower for children. and briefly I should comment on all of the things that obesity can lead to. This slide shows these. There's a long list here. They include high blood pressure, stroke, depression, sleep apnea, heart attacks, liver disease and cirrhosis, acid reflux disease, numerous cancers, gallstones, type 2 diabetes, skin fold rashes and infection, kidney failure, infertility, joint symptoms, and weakened muscles and bones. It's a very long list indeed. Now, there's a lot of things on that list that you really don't want to have. And so ultimately, obesity leads to reduced life expectancy. The problem with obesity in the pediatric patient is that very frequently it will continue to track into adulthood. Now, getting back to the study, the patients were from all areas of the US. They compared the BMI prior to the pandemic, March 1, 2019 to February 29, 2020, and they compared that to June 1, 2020 through November 30th, 2020. So the study was done over quite a short period of time, 3 to 6 months just into the pandemic. These are the overall results. This first slide shows children between the ages of 3 and 5 years with BMI on the left and time on the x-axis. They're broken down into 5 categories, which are all in blue. The solid blue line at the top is the line of severe obesity, and this group starts with a BMI of approximately 24. You can see that in that group, once the pandemic starts, the line goes markedly upwards to finish at 26. In children, the normal BMI for young children are much lower than adult BMIs, as I mentioned. But as kids age, their BMI does slowly increase to the adult range, somewhere around the age of 20. Now, the line below the severely obese line is the moderately obese line, then below that, the overweight line, below that, the normal healthy weight, and then the underweight line. Here's the legend for the different lines so you can see that. In all of the graphs, the severe obesity line is at the top, followed by moderate obesity, overweight, healthy weight, and then underweight. Now I want to show you the data for kids 6 to 11. Again, you can see quite a significant upward trend of the BMI, a much steeper angle compared to the slow increase in the pre-pandemic BMI. This rate of increase is quite significant in all groups. This slide is from the 12 to 17 year old group, and the same findings are noted. The last slide I want to show you is the 18 to 20 group. In this group, you can see that there's not as much of an increase in the slope of the line after the start of the pandemic. Now, there's a second study, a pediatric study showing the same findings. This is from Southern California in kids between 5 and 17. They compared the pre-pandemic BMI from March 2019 to January 2020 with BMI measurements at least 3 months into the pandemic, starting June 16, 2020 through January 2021. There were 191,509 children in the study, and it was quite racially and ethnically diverse. Their findings in the summary compared the pre-pandemic weights to the weights during the same length of time during the pandemic. And what they found is that the average gain amongst the 5 to 11 year olds was 2.3 kilos or 5 pounds more than normal, more than what you would expect during the reference period. Now for kids 12 to 15, it was 2.3 kilos, which again is 5 pounds. Children that were a little older, 16 or 17, it was 1.03 kilograms or 2.2 pounds, more than normal during the pandemic than during the reference period. These results in children are obviously very concerning. There are many reasons for the weight gain. School closures, increased stress, which could lead to reduced mood and depression, as well as loneliness. Their routines were disrupted. There was poor nutrition. No team sports and less physical exercise would be some of the main reasons. The concern with this, of course, is whether weight gain will continue as the pandemic continues, and of course, whether this will continue to track into adulthood. This, of course, is of great concern because if the levels of obesity that we're seeing now are ultimately going to mean that the life expectancy of children could, in fact, be less than groups of adults who are older than them. Life expectancy, of course, has been increasing over the last 100 years, And it's certainly possible with the level of obesity that we're seeing now that there may be, for the first time, a decline in life expectancy in a group of people. That would be very sad to see. I did a previous video entitled On How to Tell If You're Healthy, which is based on a clinical study in the US demonstrating that 88% of adult Americans are metabolically unhealthy. Just think about that for a minute, 88% of adult Americans. If the obesity that we're seeing from the pandemic continues, this number is going to go up even more. And it's so important for everyone, whether you're young or old, to be at an ideal weight. And proper nutrition, sleep, exercise are important in order to accomplish that. With this pandemic, it's quite clear that the virus is going to become endemic, as there are animal reservoirs, as the fact that transmission is occurring even in vaccinated people. So all of us are going to get this virus, and maybe multiple times in the future. It's going to be like the other commonly circulating coronaviruses that cause the common cold. Unfortunately, this particular coronavirus, of course, can lead to severe illness and death in a small percentage of people, as I've mentioned in previous videos on the odds of dying and odds of hospitalization with this. Now, if you're not immune, and by that I mean if you've not been vaccinated and you've not had COVID, I would recommend that you get immunity. Unfortunately, the kind of immunity that we see with vaccinated immunity is not sterilizing. And that's the kind most people think of when we use the word immunity. Sterilizing immunity means that the likelihood of you getting the infectious illness is virtually zero. Having immunity with this coronavirus clearly prevents severe disease. This is best achieved with vaccination in adults, especially if you're at higher risk. Nearly every day I talk to patients who have not been vaccinated about the risks and benefits of vaccination as it pertains to them. I talk about how to get vaccinated. The technique may be very important, which I'm going to talk about in another video. Aspirating, meaning pulling the plunger back of the syringe when the vaccination occurs before injecting, is important to prevent an intravenous injection if the needle is in a blood vessel. That doesn't happen very often, but there is a possibility of that with any vaccination. I've got numerous videos on the channel about the benefits of vaccination utilizing evidence-based medicine. In other words, the data that we know. I'd like to thank you for joining me today on Medicine with Dr. Moran. Thanks for staying till the end. I'm Dr. Keith Moran, and remember, it's important in this pandemic to get healthy and to stay healthy.